Welcome to this episode of Eureka. Imagine that you got about 20,000 rupees in the beginning of the month as your salary. You paid rent, you bought food, you spent on various things. At the end of the month, you computed how much you spent. That was 15,000 rupees. Means that you should have about 5,000 rupees in your pocket, but you have only 2,000 rupees. I'm sure you will be perplexed. That's a kind of perplexion that climate change scientists had once upon a time when they were trying to look at the amount of solar energy falling on Earth and looking at the energy being budgeted in different forms. We are going to discuss this and more with our today's guest, Dr. S.K. Satish. He is a professor at the Center for Atmospheric Sciences at Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore.
Aerosols are minute particles suspended in the atmosphere. But despite their small size, they have major impacts on our climate and our health. It is where Dr. S.K. Satish has extensively contributed in understanding of aerosols and its impact. Presently, he is the chairman of Daivecha Center for Climate Change and professor of Center for Atmospheric and Oceanic Sciences at Indian Institute of Science, Bengaluru. Dr. Satish obtained his bachelor's degree in physics in 1990 and master's in physics in 1992 with specialization in applied electronics. Later on, he conducted doctoral research at the Space Physics Laboratory, Vikram Sarabhai Space Center of ISRO, and obtained PhD in 1997 from University of Kerala under the guidance of Dr. K. Krishnamurthy. After obtaining doctorate degree, he joined Scripps Institute of Oceanography, University of California in 1998 as postdoctoral research physicist. In 2000, he joined Indian Institute of Science, Bengaluru as a faculty member. Dr. Satish has done pioneering work on black carbon aerosols, which is the light-absorbing particles that affect not just the human body, but also the climate. He elucidated how the radiation balance of the Earth atmosphere system and climate are influenced by aerosols. Professor Satish has won numerous national and international awards and recognitions, which includes the Infosys Prize 2018 by the Infosys Science Foundation, Shanti Swaroop Bhatnagar Prize in 2009, and recently with the GM Modi Innovative Science and Technology Award and the National Award of Excellence in Atmospheric Science and Technology in the year 2019.
Thank you for being with us. It's a very wonderful opportunity, very nice campus, very interesting work. I just went around, lots of interesting stuff, and I suppose very important work for future of Earth and all of us put together, right? Human being, all life forms, we all depend on understanding climate and climate change more deeply. So let me start with some fundamental questions. I mean, you study the atmosphere, that's your major aspect. One of the area what I saw in your room, you know, some of the studies that you are talking about is a word called aerosol, and you are calling it as a particle. But for me, who had studied some science in school, after all, every atom is a particle, right? I mean, after all, atmosphere is nothing but various atoms, about maybe 68% nitrogen and about 20% oxygen. They are also molecules moving here and there, right? So how do you distinguish this atmospheric, atoms from the other particles? What makes you that distinction?
Thank you for coming. Atmospheric aerosols are defined as particles or liquid phase suspended in the atmosphere. Okay. So molecules are of angstrom sized particles, and okay, particles are a typical size of an aerosol particle is 0.5 micrometer in size,
okay, uh-huh,
making it radiatively very active. Uh-huh. That is one reason aerosols are very important when we talk about radiation budget of the Earth atmospheric system.
Okay.
According to scattering theory, when the particle scatterer size is comparable to the wavelength of radiation, the scattering is maximum. Uh-huh. So the maximum in the sunlight spectrum is in the green wavelength region, that is comparable to 0.5 micrometer in size. So the interaction is much more when we talk about particles. And these aerosols are produced both naturally and anthropogenic manner, but we cannot control natural processes like sea salt produced from ocean or dust produced from desert region. But what we can do is we can control anthropogenic aerosols.
Yeah, so let me get this clear. I mean, you say that aerosols are particles which are of particular size, which are able to scatter the green light from sun. That's a kind of, if I have to understand very generally, it has to have at least that much size to be called as a aerosol particle, right?
Actually, it is defined from one size to another, say 0.01 to 100 micrometer, not only 0.5. 0.5 is the typical size of particle, but we have aerosols, we have a size distribution. It distributed from very close to nano size particles to about 100 micrometer particles. Okay. So all wavelengths in the solar spectrum and terrestrial radiation are interacting with aerosols.
You talked about naturally producing aerosol. I mean, two things that you talked about is salt from sea and dust from, let's say, desert. Okay. One would expect that salts from sea is only if you are very near to sea. Maybe you can smell some salt in the air. Or maybe if it is a deserty climate and if there is a huge wind, one sees, let's say, a dust storm. Do you mean to say that ordinarily, even around us right now, there is salt and dust in the atmosphere?
Yes. It is omnipresent, actually. Aerosols are everywhere, it is present. We don't clean the room for 2-3 days, we can see a lot of dust. That's all aerosols. And also, it is not only confined to the source region. For example, desert dust, it is produced from Saharan desert, and studies have shown that can get transported to up to 5,000 kilometers from their sources.
Okay.
It can even reach Antarctica. Uh-huh, uh-huh. So it's not only confined to the source location. Uh-huh. It will get transported due to various meteorological processes, and it can reach far distances from the sources.
Very interesting. So now when we talk about the globe, okay, one is talking about the source and then it distributed to various distances. What about the height?
It goes up also. There are several processes which can take up. For example, monsoon circulation, convection associated with the monsoon circulation can take the particle to higher levels, and atmospheric boundary layer dynamics. Early morning we have a very shallow boundary layer, but then during noontime and summer season we have very high boundary layer, that is about 2-2.5 kilometers. So it can transport particles to higher levels.
Okay, so it can go even up to 3 kilometers, 4 kilometers. Yeah. That's the kind of distance typically we are talking about. Very interesting. That's interesting. Now let me shift to some of your research work. One of your very interesting research work is with V. Ramanathan. I mean, one of the world's well-known climate researcher, right? Yeah. I mean, this was also a kind of a very path-breaking result. I mean, you looked at soot in atmosphere and then came up with a completely different answer from what was then thought. Can you describe us that?
The whole climate community focus was during early 90s, it was sulfate aerosols, which is a scattering type. So scattering type aerosols cool the planet and absorbing type aerosol warm the planet. So if we have a large amount of scattering aerosol, the net effect will be cooling, and if we have a large amount of absorbing aerosol, net effect is warming. So mostly the focus was sulfate aerosol, that is cooling aerosol, cooling agents during the early 90s. So I joined Scripps Institution of Oceanography with Professor Veerabhadran Ramanathan during 98. And the project name was Indian Ocean Experiment. And Indian Ocean, as part of Indian Ocean Experiment, the Center for Clouds, Chemistry and Climate, where I worked for my postdoc, they established a climate observatory in Republic of Maldives.
Okay.
A small island known as Kashidu. It is called Kashidu Climate Observatory. Okay. So there we have conducted lot of experiments, and satellite data also we have analyzed. We had research ships, research aircraft flying above, and in that experiment we found that for the first time we found that the effect of aerosol at the top of the atmosphere and surface are different. For a scattering type aerosol, scattering is a conservative process, there is no energy loss anywhere. So the characteristic is that the effect, radiative effect at the top of the atmosphere and surface of the earth for a scattering type aerosol is same. That means there is no net absorption, no energy is trapped in the atmosphere. But in our case, we found that top of the atmospheric radiative effect of aerosol is much smaller, almost 3 times smaller compared to its effect at the surface. That means large amount of radiation is trapped in the atmosphere because of aerosols. That gave an indication that large amount of absorbing aerosols are present in this region. That is how first time we came up with light absorbing aerosols, and that was a revolutionary expose at that time.
Okay, so what is this aerosol? I mean, we talked about salt, we talked about dust. Do they absorb, or is it some kind of a new species that you found is the culprit which is absorbing the, let's say, heat from sun?
Yeah, we provided the first experimental evidence in the field to prove that the effect of radiation at the top, aerosol at the top of the atmosphere and surface are very different. And that gave an indication about the absorbing properties of aerosols. Otherwise, it was known, sulfate, soot, all particles were known, but its effect was not demonstrated in the field any time. But sea salt is a scattering type. It doesn't absorb in the atmosphere. Dust is slightly absorbing, but not as much as black earth.
So basically, most of the absorbent is human-made.
It's a human-made, yes.
That's where the essential problem comes in. Very, very important point. This is where we'll take a very short break. Climate change, today we cannot talk without talking about the human impact, how we are making changes in the climate of the world. Keep watching Eureka. After a very short break, our conversation will continue.
My name is Omkar Nath Sharma. My age is 80 years old. और लोग मुझे मेडिसिन बाबा के नाम से जानते हैं। पब्लिक से मांग मांग के गरीबों के लिए दवाइयाँ इकट्ठी करता हूँ। मैं दवाइयाँ नहीं मांग रहा हूँ, मैं सिर्फ इंसानों की जिंदगी मांग रहा हूँ।
सरकार के लिए फिस्कल डेफिसिट के टारगेट को अचीव करने में करना पड़ेगा किन चुनौतियों का सामना, जानने के लिए देखिए अर्थनीति मेरे साथ शनिवार शाम 7:30 बजे राज्यसभा टीवी पर।
वेलकम बैक टू यूरेका। वी आर हैविंग अ वेरी इनसाइटफुल कॉन्वर्सेशन विद प्रोफेसर एस के सतीश। ही इज विद द सेंटर फॉर एटमॉस्फेरिक साइंसेस इन इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ साइंस बेंगलुरु। Well, now let me shift to another one of your major research work, which is possibly perhaps you are working like a detective at that time, right? Because all over the world people were talking about missing energy, right? You had so much of energy from sun, and when you calculate back how much is going back and how much is being absorbed in various places, things did not match. There was some anomaly. And one of your pioneering work, in fact, which you carried out with ISRO's help, solve this, right? So can you explain this?
In 2000, I joined Indian Institute of Science and established the aerosol climate observatory at this center. And at that time, the whole climate community was addressing an issue popularly known as anomalous absorption or excess atmospheric absorption, where we cannot explain part of the energy when we calculate the radiation budget. And it was attributed to various reasons. One group of people said that an unknown species is in the present. It's known as gas X hypothesis.
Okay.
And some other people said your black carbon in the model is not adequate. You have to multiply by 4. But then we are measuring the black carbon. We cannot multiply by 4. Simply, there is no logic in that. So we have done a lot of experiments with the help of ISRO. And what we have found is that when we make surface radiation measurements using radiometers and also use satellite data for the top of the atmosphere, and we found that large amount of energy is missing. We cannot account for some amount of energy. And we have tried different aspect. Yes, we multiply by black carbon by 4, yes, it will match. The modeled and observed energy, absorbed energy will be matching. But the thing is, we are measuring black carbon, so we can't multiply just like that. So we have done microscopic analysis using scanning electron microscope images and found that the density, that means the concentration of particles, are so large in this region, so the probability of them getting mixed are very high. So analyze.
No, you used the word mixing, different particles. So what is the different particle mixing actually?
Yeah, as I said, aerosols are of different types like dust, sea salt, black carbon, organic carbon, and there are several other types. It can exist independently and also in mixed state.
Okay, like they can combine into some
combine
kind of
into one particle can be coated with other particle, because a large particle can be coated with a large number of small particles.
Yeah.
So the difference, our interest in this is that when the particles are existing as independent species, its climate effect is small, and if they are mixed, it become a dangerous species, and its radiative effect and climate effect are 2 to 3 times larger.
Okay, so that actually explained the missing.
It was
energy.
Actually not missing; it was there, but we have to account in describe the aerosol properly. So we have to account the state of mixing. That also showed that all the aerosol climate impact assessment made so far at that time were unrealistic.
Okay.
Because all of them were using independent species, assuming aerosol as independent species.
No, here I want to ask you one important question. I mean, you said that you collaborated with ISRO. Not only in this study, one, if one can look at, I mean, many of your studies, there is a collaboration with ISRO. Why ISRO is interested in this? What is their take? I mean, where does they come into the picture?
Yeah, ISRO, they do lot of satellite remote sensing, and if they want to do the remote sensing of surface or ocean, they need to correct for the atmosphere. So molecular scattering is well known, Rayleigh scattering is well known, but aerosol properties are not known. So the data on aerosol is very important for them. And also ISRO is very much interested in climate related studies. Several centers, a space physics laboratory in Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, they are also National Atmospheric Research Lab in Tirupati, they are all interested in climate studies also.
Yeah, so this also kind of proves that how different areas of science are interconnected.
Yes.
That is, you are studying, your interest might be on climate change, but certain interest of ISRO also kind of mingles with your interest.
Yes.
So together you are able to understand things much better, right? This is how, I mean, where different areas of science are interconnected and then something new emerges.
Expertise from different institutions we combine together. In that way, I am fortunate to be part of Indian Institute of Science, which encourages collaboration and cooperation.
Now, one of the area that you have been focusing in Indian Institute of Science is, how do I apply this knowledge to societal benefit? Right, so that's one new thinking that has been brought in. Can you explain that part?
With this thinking, we have established the Future Earth South Asia Regional Office at this
Future center. Earth.
Future Earth. Future Earth is an international program, which is actually a merger of several international programs, including International Geosphere Biosphere Program,
okay,
and International Human Dimensions Program, and it become Future Earth, and supported by various United Nations organizations. And you also may remember that International Council for Scientific Union, that is ICSU,
yeah,
got merged with International Social Science Council,
yeah, yeah,
become International Science Council.
Yeah.
Though the idea here is that anything we do should have an impact on society. That is the idea. So with that only we have established this Future Earth, and vision of Future Earth is very simple: science for the people. And we also believe the native proverb, we do not inherit the earth from our ancestors, we borrow it from our children.
Okay.
So with that, we have a responsibility to protect our planet. So that is main thing. So we convert our knowledge, we integrate available knowledge to come up with solutions. So our motto is region specific solutions oriented. So we come up with solutions to tackle the consequences of climate change.
Very, very important point, and this is where we will take a very short break. Keep watching Eureka. After the break, we are going to at least see few of such examples of how knowledge in fundamental science about climate change is being used to understand some of the human problems. Keep watching Eureka. After a short break, we'll continue this conversation.
मेरा नाम ओमकार नाथ शर्मा है, मेरी उम्र 80 साल की है और लोग मुझे मेडिसिन बाबा के नाम से जानते हैं। पब्लिक से मांग मांग के गरीबों के लिए दवाइयाँ इकट्ठी करता हूँ। मैं दवाइयाँ नहीं मांग रहा हूँ, मैं सिर्फ इंसानों की ज़िंदगी मांग रहा हूँ।
Korean cosmetic market is the 8th largest in the world. It is growing at a very fast pace and now is exploring new markets for this industry.
We advanced biomedical technology and all Botox components, also stem cell and natural killer cell components.
If you see the South Koreans, everyone looks good, looks beautiful or handsome. Lots of research are going on in South Korea about how to remove the wrinkles.
Watch our special report, South Korea Cosmetics Stopover, Sunday at 7:30 p.m., Monday at 11 a.m., only on Rajya Sabha Television.
Welcome back to Eureka. We are having a very wonderful and insightful conversation with Professor S.K. Satish, who is with the Center for Atmospheric Sciences at Indian Institute of Science, Bengaluru. Let me ask you this question. It's a very curious point. I mean, if one looks at your curriculum vitae, I mean, you did physics with electronics. Basically, you wanted to become electronics engineer. But you are in climate change studies, atmospheric studies. How this shift actually happened?
I was doing master's in physics with applied electronics as specialization in University of Kerala. And I have done a project using a high frequency radar system at the University Department of Physics. The purpose of that radar was to study ionosphere. So at that time ionosphere was important because of satellite ground communication. It can deteriorate the signals. So my project was to design and fabricate a pulse generator for that radar. But then I was also interested in the science coming out of that.
Okay.
So that is what first made me interested in space science, atmospheric and space science. And then after a master's program, I got selected for a PhD program in Vikram Sarabhai Space Center Space Physics Laboratory. Mm. Then I started in lower atmosphere. Then I found that lower atmosphere is much more we are all living close to the Earth's surface, so lower atmospheric studies will have much more implications to society than upper atmosphere. So I got interested in lower atmosphere and climate.
Okay, so that's how, I mean, you shifted to, you are coming from a very small remote village, from a very ordinary family. What made you in your life to, what inspired you? What made you said that I will perform, I'll do things? What was your source of inspiration?
I am born and brought up in a small village known as Peringadavila in southern part of Thiruvananthapuram in Kerala state. So I did all my schooling in government school and Malayalam medium. So I had this habit of adopting good qualities from others from childhood. As I said, I am from a very ordinary family and very ordinary person with no special abilities. So my father and brother, I adopted first qualities in school. I mean, my father was very honest and my brother was very hardworking. So these two I have adopted, and in my website even now I put my self-assessment as hardworking, sincere and dedicated. These are the three things which is
very, very interesting. See, this Future Earth which you are leading, for Future Earth for Southeast Asia, the headquarters is here and you are heading it. We also talked about how this whole idea is to see that how fundamental research can be made into societal knowledge, solving certain societal problems. Can you give us one or two examples of how climate change research is also providing some input to understanding some of our human problems?
Okay, one is air quality and health, because air quality, this presence of large amount of aerosol, it's not only a problem for climate but also for human health.
Yeah.
So we collaborate with medical doctors, mm-hmm. and we give them information about the aerosol types and number concentration, and we are trying to find what effect it has on impact,
okay.
on especially
okay.
school children. Uh-huh. Now starting with the school children.
So basically it will have a lot of impact on the respiratory diseases, right?
So there are several reports saying that when the traffic density doubled, the respiratory illness also increased. There are so many studies in India.
Okay.
So we are trying.
So the medical profession and atmospheric researchers can combine together and study it, which will have a better effect. Another example?
Future Earth is an interdisciplinary program. So we do only interdisciplinary thing, nothing with one discipline. Even our PhD students, it is mandatory to have two supervisors from two different disciplines. So another example is decarbonization of Indian power sector is one topic which we addressed recently. We need people from economics background, and we need people from climate background, and we need engineers.
Okay.
Because economics, whatever we do for mitigating the emission, there will be an impact on economics too. So we are making them as a team and work towards that, how much economics will be affected if we follow this particular mitigation strategy. And also another example is agriculture. Monsoon, we are very familiar with the monsoon, but we do not know agriculture. So we collaborate with agriculture scientists and come up with the effect on food security, whether the country will be able to feed the population after, say, 2050. For that, we need support from agricultural scientists and other disciplines, scientists from other disciplines.
So by linking with various disciplines, we are able to actually do also good basic science and also produce societally useful knowledge. That's very interesting part. Lastly, we don't have much time, but this one struck me very much. I mean, when we talked about your first research about soot being present in atmosphere, why this is present more in countries like India and not, for example, in developed countries? Why they are not seeing this as a major problem?
My feeling is that we have more emissions here as far as black carbon is concerned, because 30 to 40% of black carbon is coming from developing nations, not developed countries. And because of that, aerosol problem is not just a science problem anymore. And it involves several issues, but not limited to international policy and health as well. So my feeling is that we are not implementing the regulations. I don't think we don't have a regulation. We have adequate regulations in the country, but implementation need much more attention. So if we implement the regulation strictly, I think we can control the emission, that is black carbon emission from vehicles.
So which is the main source of, or let's say first two, three, big source of black carbon emission in India?
Any kind of burning can produce black carbon. Thermal, coal-fired thermal power plants, a major source. And vehicular emission is another source. And any kind of biomass burning, like stubble burning, agricultural burning, also can contribute to black carbon.
So the black carbon is one important challenge for India. Although we need different technology, like one of the things that you were talking about, converting coal power plants with lesser emission of soot, things of this kind, it's a challenge that we need to address, right?
It's not only a local problem, as I said, it is an international policy issue also, because there are several in international treaties and all, developed countries are demanding that black carbon should be part of the negotiation.
Okay.
So it is international policy also.
Yes, getting involved. Very nice. I mean, it has been a very insightful, very informative conversation. Thank you for being in the show. Keep watching Reka. We'll come back with another interesting conversation next week, same time.
मेरा नाम ओमकार नाथ शर्मा है।